أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه ونؤمن به ونتوكل عليه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، ونشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، له الملك وله الحمد، يحيي ويميت، وهو حي لا يموت، بيده الخير، وهو على كل شيء قدير. وأشهد أن سيدنا وحبيبنا وعظيمنا وقائدنا وقرة أعيننا محمدًا عبده ورسوله وصفيه وخليله، بلغ الرسالة وأدى الأمانة ونصح الأمة وكشف الغمة وجاهد في الله حق جهاده حتى أتاه اليقين، صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه ومن تبعهم وعنا معهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. عباد الله، فإني أوصيكم ونفسي بتقوى الله العلي العظيم. يقول الله تعالى في القرآن الكريم: يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله، اتقوا الله حق تقاته، ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله، وخير الحدي حدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. ربنا آتنا من لدنك رحمة وهيئ لنا من أمرنا رشدا. My dear brothers and sisters in Islam, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi ta'ala wa barakatuhu. Alhamdulillah, with the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we have almost reached the end of Ramadan. And I sincerely ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to extend our lives a few more days so that we can witness the completion of Ramadan. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to reward us for our humble efforts in this blessed month, regardless of the very many shortcomings we might have had along the way. And I also ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to remove this pandemic, to remove this disease from all of us, so that we can get back to worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a way that we should. Allahumma ameen wa akhra da'wan alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. In this month, my dear brothers and sisters, we often heard this ayah over and over again, just even before we started having that, even before the month of Ramadan, we started sending out reminders about the month of Ramadan. We've had many preparatory talks about the month of Ramadan, where we heard the words, Ya ayyuhalladhina amanu kutiba alaykum as-siyamu kama kutiba ala alladhina min qablikum la'allakum tattaqun. That, O you who have believed, decreed upon you is fasting as it was decreed upon people before you, so that you become the people of taqwa. La'allakum tattaqun. So that you become God conscious. By the way, taqwa is an abstract concept. It is a characteristic. It is something that we continuously work to improve. No one can say after fasting 1 month of Ramadan or a few years of Ramadan, they can say that I have achieved 100% of taqwa. Taqwa does not work that way. The idea is to get better every year and move the needle in the right direction and not go back. Taqwa does not have a cap. Taqwa does not have a higher limit where we can just say that we have achieved 100% taqwa. Taqwa is something that we have to improve year over year, day after day, month after month. This is something that we have to work on continuously. But how do we know? How do we know that we have moved the needle of taqwa in the right direction? We know that we have to get better. We have to become more God conscious. But how do you know that you have moved the needle of taqwa in the right direction? Let me give an example. Let's say there's a student who says that he wants to become the most knowledgeable in physics. How does he go about that? How does he measure himself that he has the most knowledge in physics? So he has to go through some guideposts. He has to meet some intermediary goals before he can call, okay, I have at least some amount of knowledge in physics. He has to get through the elementary and high school physics, then he has to go through the college level physics, then he has to go through the university or the graduate level physics, then he does some PhDs or multiple PhDs, after which he can say, yes, I have achieved a good amount of understanding, a good amount of knowledge in physics. But how do we say, what are the guideposts that we can use, to say that we have achieved some level of taqwa? None of us are going to ever say that we have achieved 100% of taqwa, but at least we can say that we are moving in the right direction. What guideposts that we can use? What goals that we can try to achieve? And for a moment, let's call, for the purpose of this talk, let's call these guideposts and goals as positive traits or characteristics that we need to develop during the month of Ramadan and practice after the month of Ramadan as well. And we don't have to dream up or make up these traits or characteristics that we need to develop. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He has taught us, He has told us what characteristics that we need to build so that inshallah we can move the needle on taqwa in the right direction. And again, our goal is not to go through these traits in this short reminder today, but all these traits are mentioned in the ayat of Siyam, starting from ayah number 183 of Surah Al-Baqarah all the way to ayah number 187. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He describes various characteristics that we can try to achieve so that we can say that we are moving the needle on taqwa in the right direction. Like I said, my goal is not to go through those characteristics, but I want to focus on one of the traits that we all should strive to achieve this Ramadan, next Ramadan, throughout our life. And I'm going to, inshallah, focus on one of the stories of the most tested prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to understand this characteristic, to understand this trait that we need to develop. And that prophet is none other than Ayyub alayhi salam. May Allah have mercy on him. Ayyub alayhi salam, the Quran says, ووهبنا له إسحاق ويعقوب كلا هدينا ونوحا هدينا من قبل ومن ذرية داود وسليمان وأيوب ويونس وموسى وهارون وكذلك نجزي المحسنين. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says this in Surah Al-An'am. And before I go further, I want to mention that the information that you're going to hear from me about Ayyub alayhi salam is primarily from the book called Qasas al-Anbiya by Ibn Kathir, the stories of the prophets by Ibn Kathir. And some of the information that he presented in that book are from the stories of Bani Israel. We don't find them in the Quran, we don't find them in the Sunnah. So he basically took them as historical information. I also want you to take it as such. And we don't take this to be a concrete proof. This is something that is historically presented. So we just take them as historical information. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the words of Surah Al-An'am, He says that Ayyub alayhi salam, he is from the lineage of Ishaq alayhi salam and Ibrahim alayhi salam. As a matter of fact, some scholars say that Ayyub alayhi salam not only had a noble lineage on his father's side, but he also had a noble lineage on the mother's side. They say that his mother was from the lineage of Lut alayhi salam. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He praises Ayyub alayhi salam in the Quran. And He says, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in Surah Sa'd, Inna wajadnahu sabira, ni'am al-abdu innahu awwab. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He mentions three characteristics of Ayyub alayhi salam in this ayah. The first thing that He says, Ayyub alayhi salam, he was the most patient person. who shows utmost gratitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that was his first characteristic, is patience with utmost gratitude to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ni'am al-abid, he is an excellent worshipper to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the third characteristic is innahu awwab, that he returns to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala constantly. He continuously repents to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He continuously turns back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Ibn Kathir, he mentions an incident in his book where the angels are having some discussions amongst themselves. The angels are talking amongst themselves, and some of them saying, the humble ones on this earth, they earn the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the arrogant ones, they earn the displeasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. At this moment, one angel, he said that the best person on the earth at this moment is Ayyub alayhi salam. Ayyub alayhi salam, he had the best noble character. He had the utmost patience, and he always remembers Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the angel said that he is an excellent role model and example for the believers. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as a result, he blessed Ayyub alayhi salam with a long and healthy life, a good wife, plenty of wealth, with a lot of children and a lot of servants, and the poor and needy, they shared in his good fortune. And he constantly fed and clothed the poor, and he also used to set the slaves free. And the people who got the charity from Ayyub alayhi salam, Ayyub alayhi salam made them feel as if they were helping Ayyub alayhi salam. By taking the charity from Ayyub alayhi salam, Ayyub alayhi salam made them feel as if the people who are taking the charity, they are helping Ayyub alayhi salam. Ayyub alayhi salam, he had this utmost noble character. And Iblis, he overheard this conversation of the neighbor, of the angels, and he became very jealous. He became annoyed, he became disappointed, and he tried to attempt to corrupt Ayyub alayhi salam. He went to Ayyub alayhi salam in his prayers, and he tried to put whispers and insinuations in the ears of Ayyub alayhi salam, saying, why are you doing all this prayer? Why can't you spend your wealth in a different way? Why do you have to spend all your time in the prayer? Why do you have to always return back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? He tried to distract Ayyub alayhi salam from his worship, but being a true believer, Ayyub alayhi salam, he stood fast in his iman, and this made Iblis hate Ayyub alayhi salam even more. And Iblis, one time, he went to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to complain about Ayyub alayhi salam. And Ayyub alayhi salam, he told about Ayyub alayhi salam to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that Ayyub is doing all these things. Ayyub is only worshipping you and glorifying you because he does not want to lose his wealth. He has a lot of wealth. He has a lot of farms. He has a lot of cattle and sheep and servants. He doesn't want to lose all of this. And he's just worshipping you and glorifying you just to show off and out of greed and out of greed for wealth. He's not sincere to you. And Iblis said to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if he were to take this wealth away from Ayyub, then he will not glorify you and then he will not worship you. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he told Iblis that Ayyub alayhi salam, he was a sincere believer. However, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he wanted to show Iblis how sincere Ayyub alayhi salam was in his worship. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he allowed his wealth to be taken away. So all his cattle, all his sheep, the servants and the farms, all his possessions, they went away. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allowed his wealth to go away. At this moment, Iblis came in the form of an old man in front of Ayyub alayhi salam. And he said to Ayyub alayhi salam, you are in this state. You are in the state of dissoluteness, or you're in the state of not having wealth because you gave away all your wealth for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and you wasted your time praying for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and Ayyub alayhi salam, he said, what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has taken away from me belongs to him. I was only its trustee for a while. He gives to whom he wills and withholds from whom he wills. Ayyub alayhi salam, he fell down in prostration and made sujood to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And again, this made Iblis more angry, and he went to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala again to complain about Ayyub alayhi salam. And he said, Iblis said to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ayyub is only praying to you because of his children. He knows that his children are more important than his wealth, and he doesn't want his children to be taken away. And the greatest test a man could go through in this life is through his children. So if you take away his children from you, you will know the true color of Ayyub alayhi salam. He will stop worshiping you. He will stop glorifying you. Then again, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allowed his children to be taken away from him. All of them passed away. All of them died. And this time Iblis disguised as a young man, and he came to Ayyub alayhi salam, and he said to Ayyub alayhi salam, it's really sad how your children died, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not answering your prayers. And Ayyub alayhi salam, he said, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, sometimes he gives and sometimes he takes. He is sometimes pleased and sometimes he is displeased with our deeds. Whether a thing is beneficial or harmful to me, I will remain firm in my belief and remain thankful to my creator. Again, Ayyub alayhi salam, he fell down in prostration to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Of course, this further irritated Iblis, and he went back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he said, Ya Allah, Ayyub is still worshipping you because of his good health. He thinks that he can use his good health in the hopes of regaining his wealth and producing more children. So if you take away his health, if you take away his health, then you will know, you will find that Ayyub will no longer worship you, that you will find that Ayyub will no longer glorify you. Then of course, in this scenario, in this case, in this instant, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala allowed Ayyub alayhi salam to be inflicted with a skin disease. And that disease reduced Ayyub alayhi salam to mere skin and bone, and he also suffered a great pain as well. And some scholars say all his internal organs became ill, except for his heart and tongue, which he used to remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He was constantly praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with his tongue and with his heart. And Ayyub alayhi salam, as he was going through this pain and disease, and the disease was very visible over his skin, over the body, and people started going away from him. The family started retreating from him. The friends went away from him. Everyone deserted him except his wife. And one time Iblis, in the form of a man, came to the wife of Ayyub alayhi salam, and he started to remind her about all the good old times. The times when they had a lot of wealth, when Ayyub alayhi salam had a lot of good health, he had a lot of children and whatnot, and how they enjoyed life. And this made the wife of Ayyub alayhi salam slip for a moment. He said to Ayyub alayhi salam, that how long do you have to endure this torture from your Lord? Are we to remain without wealth? Are we to remain without children and friends forever? Why don't you ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to remove this suffering? And Ayyub alayhi salam, he was surprised to hear this from his wife. And then he asked his wife, how long did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala keep me hale and healthy? And the wife said, 80 years. And how long have I been suffering? And she said, 7 years. Then Ayyub alayhi salam, he said, then I am ashamed to call upon my Lord, for I have not suffered longer than the years of good health and wealth. I have only suffered for 7 years when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has granted me 80 years of good health and wealth. And I am ashamed to go back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and pray to him. And Ayyub alayhi salam, he also made he took an oath that if he ever were to regain his health, that he would lash his wife 100 times out of anger. And Ayyub alayhi salam, he also stopped eating and drinking from his wife. So with a heavy heart, Ayyub alayhi salam, he returned to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not to complain, but to seek the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he mentions the pleading of Ayyub alayhi salam in a couple of places in the Quran. One is in Surah Al-Anbiya, another one is in Surah Al-Sa'd. And for the sake of time, I'm just going to go through one of them. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran about this incident, وَذُكُرْ عَبْدَنَا أَيُّوبَ إِذْ نَادَى رَبَّهُ أَنِّي مَسَّنِيَ الشَّيْطَانُ بِنُصْبٍ وَعَذَابٍ. And Ayyub alayhi salam, he called upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and he said, indeed, Satan has touched me with hardship and torment. Of course, the good health and the illness, they don't come except with the permission of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But look at the adab of Ayyub alayhi salam. He blamed Iblis in this ayah, and he blamed in another ayah. He said that evil has touched me. He did not complain about Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He did not say that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given this to me. In this ayah, he said, Shaitan has touched me with hardship and torment. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he gave him a way out. He said, Urqud bi rijlik, strike the ground with your foot. Hada mughtasilun baridun wa sharab. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said that this is a spring for a cool bath and drink. And he, Ayyub alayhi salam, he took a wash from that spring, and he also drank from it, and that cured Ayyub alayhi salam, and he became beautiful and healthy again. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also, he continues in the surah, وَوَهَبْنَا لَهُ أَهْلَهُ وَمِثْلَهُمْ مَعْهُمْ رَحْمَةً مِنَّا وَذِكْرَى لِوُلِي الْأَلْبَابِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said that he gave back his health, he gave back his wealth, and he also gave back his children. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala restored everything to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And my dear brothers, this is the trait that we have to remember and try to follow during the month of Ramadan and also past the month of Ramadan. This trait, which is being grateful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with patience, even under difficult circumstances, is what many of us don't gain from fasting, which is one of the key ingredients to improve and achieve taqwa towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says this in the Quran. In the ayat of Siyam, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, شهر رمضان الذي أنزل فيه القرآن هدى للناس, when he said, the month of Ramadan is that in which was revealed the Quran, a guidance for the people. How did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala complete that ayah? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, وَلِتُكْمِلُوا الْعِدَّةِ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, وَلِتُكْمِلُوا الْعِدَّةَ وَلِتُكَبِّرُوا اللَّهَ عَلَى مَا هَدَاكُمْ وَلَعَلَّكُمْ تَشْكُرُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said, he wants you to complete the period and to glorify Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for that which he has guided you, so that you may become grateful. لَعَلَّكُمْ تَشْكُرُونَ. One of the main goals of fasting is to become people of gratitude. People of gratitude, people of thankfulness towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is something that we often forget and gain from a fasting. Ramadan is not just about obligatory worship and devotion to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but it is also an act of gratefulness to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he gave us the Quran in the month of Ramadan. He gave us the light of Quran in the month of Ramadan. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says in Surah Al-An'am, أَوَمَنْ كَانَ مَيْتًا فَأَحْيَيْنَاهُ وَجَعَلْنَا لَهُ نُورًا يَمْشِي بِهِ فِي النَّاسِ كَمَنْ مَثَلُهُ فِي الظُّلُمَاتِ لَيْسَ بِخَارِجٍ مِّنْهَا كَذَلِكَ زُيِّنَ لِلْكَافِرِينَ مَا كَانُوا يَعْلَمُونَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he presents an example of the one who has received guidance from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the one who is in utter darkness. People are trying to figure out what is right and wrong in this life. People are trying to separate good from evil in this life without any guidance. They just make up their own minds. And this separation of right and wrong, this separation of good and evil, they change from time to time. What was okay, what was not okay 50 years ago, it becomes okay now. What was not okay 50 years ago, it becomes okay now. And what was okay 50 years ago, it becomes not okay now. Things change. If we leave people to their devices, people will keep on changing what is right and what is wrong according to their whims and desires. People, they grope in utter darkness and try to get whatever that they want to get based on their own interests, based on their own desires. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he did not leave us without any guidance. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he gave us the guidance of this light. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says in this ayah, and is the one who was dead, and we gave him life, and made for him light by which to walk among the people. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he gave us the light of the Quran to walk amongst the people with pure light, with pure knowledge, with clear vision. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is asking a rhetorical question. Is this person like the one who is in darkness, in utter darkness, never to emerge therefrom? Thus it has been made pleasing to the disbelievers that which they were doing. My dear brothers and sisters, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He commands us to be grateful to Him. He commands us to be grateful to Him. Because what did Shaitan say? What did Shaitan say to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Shaitan said to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَلَا تَجِدُ أَكْثَرُهُمْ شَاكِرِينَ. Shaitan told Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that you will not find none of them to be grateful, or not, he said, and he said that many of them will not be grateful to you. Shaitan, he told Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that you will not find much of humanity grateful to you. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he reminded us in the Quran, be grateful to me, be grateful to me. Fadkuruni adhkurukum. So remember me, I will remember you. And be grateful to me. Washkuruli wala takfurun. And be grateful to me and do not be ungrateful to me. Because Shaitan, he said that to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that much of humanity will not be grateful to you. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, you need to be grateful to me. And this is the characteristic that we need to develop in the month of Ramadan, when we have to practice it outside the month of Ramadan. Just imagine what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given us a life. Many of us don't have any kind of problems, any kind of health issues, no organ deficiencies. We have a nice home, we have good food, we have nice intellect, we have good children. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also has shown us many ways to expiate our countless sins. Ramadan, a month of blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, will wipe out all your shortcomings if we do it in the right way. And the Laylatul Qadr, if you catch Laylatul Qadr, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, it is equivalent to 1,000 months. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's blessing is countless. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's blessing is countless. But even with the ever-growing infections and the deaths of COVID-19, most of us are doing well by the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Our families are safe, our children are safe and healthy. And even the ones who are affected by the disease, their sins are being washed off for every single second they suffer from the disease. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He also says, it is a sign that He loves you, for especially for those people who are going through this disease, especially for those Muslims who are going through this disease. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He said through the mouth of Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, man yuridillahu bi khair yusibu minh. If Allah intends good for someone, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will afflict them with some trials. So if a person, even if he is going through some trials during this pandemic, know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is intending some good for you. And in another hadith, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, a man came to Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and he asked, O Messenger of Allah, which of the people is tried most severely? And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, the prophets, then those who are nearest to them, then those nearest to them. A man is tried according to his religion. If someone is more strong in his religion, then his tests become more severe. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, the servant shall continue to be tested and tried until he is left walking upon the earth without any sins. And I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to remove this disease from the people, from the humanity as soon as possible. And especially from our Muslim brothers and sisters. And for those sisters who are going through this disease, I sincerely ask that you exercise patience and sabr so that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will wash away all your sins and make a place for you in Jannah. And for the Muslims who have passed due to the disease, they have earned the status of martyrs with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they will get their reward in the hereafter when they meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says in the Quran, وَآتَاكُمْ مِنْ كُلِّ مَا سَعَلْتُمُوحُ وَإِنْ تَعُدُّوا نِعْمَةُ اللَّهِ لَا تُحْصُوهَا إِنَّ الْإِنسَانَ لَظَلُومٌ كَفَّارٌ. That if you were to enumerate, if you were to count the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you will not be able to do it. Even the COVID-19 is a blessing in disguise. is a blessing in disguise, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He wanted to remind us of the blessings that we don't count them as blessings. Just imagine, we just going out for a walk. We're not able to go out for a walk. We're not able to go out for a ride with family. We're not able to visit our families and friends. We're not able to go out, accept invitations and go eat out or eat in our families. We eat with our families or with our friends. We're not able to go to masajid. We're not able to go to grocery shopping or clothes shopping. We're not able to shake hands and hug each other. We're not even able to breathe free air freely without wearing the masks. And we considered many of these activities as chosen boring. But now we realize, with COVID-19, that we realize these are indeed blessings from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And again, وَإِن تَعُدُّوا نِعْمَةَ اللَّهِ لَا تُحْصُوهَا. That if you try to count the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you will never be able to count. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَغَفُورُ الرَّحِيمُ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He is the Ghafoor and He is the Rahim. And I'll complete with this reminder. My dear brothers and sisters, the sign of wisdom is to thank Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because a wise person knows where the blessings came from. Where the blessings came from. Every single blessing that we have in our life, it comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And if you want that blessing to continue, you have to make sure that you be grateful to that person. Again, you can take this example at work. Your company is the one, your employer is the one who is paying you. And you don't want to make your employer unhappy or angry. You don't want to be ungrateful to your employee. If you were to be ungrateful, if you'd make your employer angry, then of course you're not going to get that salary. But here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who gave you life, who gave you all the blessings that you have, it is the sign of wisdom that you practice shukr. And like I said, one of the main ingredients, one of the traits that we have to develop in the month of Ramadan and practice it outside the month of Ramadan for years to come, is the aspect of shukr, is the characteristic and the trait of shukr. I remind yourself and myself that we need to be thankful to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for our own benefit, and to continuously earn the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Wa akhiru da'wana alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Inshallah, we will conclude this with the dua. A'udhu billahi minash shaitanir rajim. Bismillahir rahmanir rahim. Alhamdulillah. Alhamdulillah alladhi anzala ala abdihi al-kitaba wa lam yaj'al lahu 'iwaja. Allahumma salli ala sayyidina Muhammad wa ala ali Muhammad wa sallim tasliman kathira. Allahumma qasim lana min khashyatika ma tahulu bihi baynana wa bayna ma'siyatik, wa min ta'atika ma tuballighuna bihi jannatak. ومن اليقين ما تهون به علينا مصائب الدنيا ومتعنا اللهم بأسماعنا وأبصارنا وقواتنا ما أبقيتنا واجعله الوارث منا واجعل ثأرنا على من ظلمنا وانصرنا على من عادانا ولا تجعل مصيبتنا في ديننا ولا تجعل الدنيا أكبر همنا ولا مبلغ علمنا ولا إلى النار مصيرنا واجعل الجنة هي دارنا ولا تسلط علينا بذنوبنا من لا يخافك فينا ولا يرحمنا اللهم تقبل منا إنك أنت السميع العليم وتب علينا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم اللهم إنك عفو كريم تحب العفو فاعفو عنا اللهم إنك عفو كريم تحب العفو فاعفو عنا اللهم إنك عفو كريم تحب العفو فاعفو عنا اللهم أحسن عاقبتنا في الأمور كلها وأجرنا من خزي الدنيا وعذاب الآخرة اللهم إنا نسألك إيمانا كاملا ويقينا صادقا ولسانا ذاكرة وقلبا خاشعة وتوبة نصوحة وتوبة نصوحة وتوبة قبل الموت وراحة عند الموت والعفو عند الحساب ونسألك الجنة ونعيمها ونعوذ بك من النار يا رب العالمين ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين جزاكم الله خيرا عيد مبارك to all of you. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala enable us to enjoy the day of Eid with our families, at least virtually, inshallah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala remove this pandemic from us as soon as possible so that we can get back to seeing one another and get back to visiting the house of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allahumma ameen. Assalamu alaikum wa jazakum Allahu khairan.
Allah.